3, 2, 1. Welcome back, fight fans. We're here for another episode of Shootin' the Shit Combat Press. As your host, I am always Riley Kontek. As I said that backwards, like I was in Star Wars. We have another great guest for the show this week. He will be headlining Fury FC this weekend on UFC Fight Pass. It will also be on Dana White's Looking for a Fight on YouTube, so keep an eye on that. We have Trey Ogden on the show. Trey, how are you doing today?
Good, brother. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for joining us. So, you know, the first thing we're going to talk about, you train for Glory MMA. I mean, first off, I think 2 weeks ago on the show, we had Derek Minner, who also trains there as well. Yep. So we'll keep in the tradition there. But yeah, you were saying, so you train at Glory, and then, so kind of just tell us about, you said you own a branch yourself?
Yeah, so I've been training at Glory MMA for a long time with Coach James Krause. He's been my head coach for all 18 of my pro fights. And I taught the adult jiu-jitsu at that gym for quite a while, several years. And then when the quarantine happened, I had already signed a lease to open a third Glory MMA 20 minutes away from Krause's side on the Kansas side, or 20 minutes away from Krause's location on the Kansas side. His is on the Missouri side. And then so I had already signed the lease. And so we opened a location June 1st, 2020. And that's the one I run, and I have a fight team there, and it has just exploded. We just last week finished expanding into the vacant space next to us. And now it's not big. I got 20 plus fighters on that team. And so it's great.
So your location, do you just do the pro fighters, or do you also have classes for outsiders and amateurs?
Yeah, we have all of our classes are open to everybody. And so our fighters train right next to casual members. I'm a lifelong martial artist. So like, I knew even when I was a kid that I wanted to have a dojo for a living. Like that's what I wanted to do, is teach martial arts all day and do martial arts all day. And that's before I started fighting. And so I'm in there teaching the most effective martial art I can possibly teach, six to 8 hours a day for whoever's there to get it. And our fight team at that location, since we opened our rookie year, we came out, I think my guys are 32-4. So that seems to be a very effective model for us. It's working great.
Awesome. Well, glad to hear, and congratulations on opening that up. Now, obviously, the meat and the potatoes we're going to be talking about today is you have a fight upcoming. First off, there's a couple intangibles here. You'll be fighting in the main event, as far as I can tell. What is it going to mean to fight in a main event? And in that same vein, does that add any additional pressure?
Not at all. It originally was scheduled for the co-main, but either way, it was already a five-round title fight. And so that's really all that matters. But it's nice to have the main event spot. That always amplifies it's bigger energy, but it doesn't add any pressure or nerves to me. Like, no matter where you're at, what name is on the canvas of the cage you're fighting in, the city you're fighting in, who's in the crowd, it's all a fight. Once you're in there, cage door shut, it's you, one other guy, someone's got to make a kill. So that's where my head's at. I don't really think past that about the other things too much, but obviously the event itself is big energy, and so I'm excited about that.
Yeah, very good. And actually a really, really stacked card from top to bottom. This is obviously one that Dana White's got his hands involved in, because there's a lot of top level guys fighting on that card. So your opponent, he's a Contender Series veteran, if I'm not mistaken. I believe he's also fought in Bellator, is JJ Okanovich. Coming off a pretty good win for himself as well, beating a top prospect. So what are your thoughts on JJ as an opponent? What does he do well? What are you going to try to expose?
Honestly, like, I'm not that impressed by JJ. He's pretty basic everywhere. He doesn't present any danger factor. He fancies himself a striker. He doesn't knock anybody out. He can't stop a takedown on the cage. Can't stop a takedown open mat. He doesn't have any offensive takedowns. Most of his wins are arm bars from close guard. You're not going to arm bar me from close guard. Like, I just don't see, like, a lot of he's coming off two decisions in a row, maybe three. He looked kind of somewhat sloppy after about the eight-minute mark in both of those. He fought – we have a mutual opponent, Lucas Clay. He got dominated for 15 minutes by Lucas Clay. My fight with Lucas is hard to find, and that's probably good. So I dominated Lucas Clay for 15 minutes. Like, so JJ is a good fighter. He's not a great fighter. He looks to be athletic. He's going to fight hard. Obviously, this is a big opportunity. But I don't think he'll be able to handle me. I think I'm levels above JJ.
And even if you're saying that, I totally understand that. But a guy of his experience, you know, he has fought at a high level. Do you think that that presents any sort of advantage in that he has those experiences and that, you know, even in the same way, fighting in front of Dana White, he's already done it once.
Yeah, I have more fights than him by a lot. He has 10 pro fights. I have 18 pro fights. I have more finishes than he has wins. I have more experience than him. I fought better fighters than him overall. I fought better guys than he's fought. I beat better guys in 2015, 16 than he's even fought yet. So I don't, you know, like I respect him and I train hard for everybody, but I don't think that he's gonna feel like he's the more experienced guy in the cage. And I don't think this is gonna be that competitive, but it's a fight, you never know.
Are you surprised? Because I know you said that you didn't think his striking was that great. Are you surprised he's not more of a knockout artist or more skilled than you're giving him credit for, considering he does fight with American Kickboxing Academy?
Yeah, I mean, he trains at a good gym and he's obviously going to be well trained and he's going to be used to I would accept like a really high level in his live rounds and his training, like, right? So he's going to have seen it all. But, you know, like, narratives are narratives. So where you train and who your training partner's with and all that, like, I'm just looking at the fights. I just watch his fights. I've watched his last three fights. They all went to decision. I think in his last fight that he won, he got dropped. He didn't drop the other guy, he got dropped. So it's like, I'm just being objective about it, you know. I don't see a lot of danger factor out of JJ, but I do think he's a good fighter. He's solid everywhere, you know. There's not like big gaping holes, but it's like he's not coming out here and putting everyone away with impressive fashion. His last fight was a split decision win. Like I said, he got dominated by Lucas Clay. Like, you know, it's like he's a good fighter, but this is a great matchup for me, so I'm really grateful for the opportunity.
Absolutely. Now, and stop. Well, maybe we'll stop talking about him as much as you. Now, obviously, you're not going to give your game plan away. No fighter ever would. But what do you need to do to go in there and be successful? Like, what is your most dominant quality, or what do you think is going to get it done for you?
Like, I think that, and when we took this fight, I felt this way. I think that if neither of us even trained for this fight the last 8 weeks, and you just put us in a cage, what's going to happen is what's going to happen. And I think that I'm going to dominate him everywhere if I just fight like I fight. I fight a lot longer than him. I'm a lot faster than him. I cover distance better than him. I grapple way better than him. You know, it's no secret, man. I choke everybody out. I come to, you know, smack your head around until you give me your neck, and then I put you away. And that's what'll happen here again.
Now, when you say when you choke people out, and this is more of a physical fitness question, do you think, because there's always an argument I have with my friends, do you think that pure physical strength is more important when it comes to choking guys out? Do you think there's leverage involved with the length of limbs? What do you think is the most important aspect of that?
A positional knowledge. These chokes work for a reason. And like, I'm a jujitsu black belt, and I teach jujitsu 4 hours a day every day, as well as MMA the other 4 hours a day every day. And when you teach like an arm triangle choke, after you have somewhat of a feel for it, and then you watch rep after rep after rep after rep of like so many different people try to figure out the choke, and you see why it's not working, and you see this pattern happen over the mat like all day every day, you start to understand that. It like okay, so, and this is what I tell my students, like, 80% squeeze. Like, don't you should never squeeze your hardest to choke somebody out. You should adjust the choke, because, or any submission, because, like, if jiu-jitsu will work for somebody 30 pounds smaller than you, like a rear naked choke will work for somebody 30% weaker than you. So you clearly don't need all your strength. You need the position correct. And you know, that's with all of the chokes. A rear naked choke probably has the most room for air, the most room to muscle, you know, maybe guillotine as well. But when you get into like a triangle choke, there's 20 details, and the better you get all 20 details, the more efficient your choke's gonna be. And it shouldn't be that hard to put somebody asleep. What's hard is to get them trapped. But once you have them trapped, the mechanical leverage of jiu-jitsu is incredible. Like, you know, it doesn't take that much to snap someone's arm or heel hook someone and blow their leg out or choke someone to sleep.
Yeah, no doubt about that, and we've seen
And
it.
more to that point, like, a different thing that you and your friends could start to play with is which is more important, technique or endurance? Because I can tell you, endurance is more important than strength. The strong guys with no endurance aren't going to last long. It's like endurance is like at the end of a really hard 4-minute scramble, do you have the gas to lock in a body triangle and squeeze for 45 seconds if someone's got their chin tucked and break through their jaw and choke them out? That's going to be more to do with endurance and technique.
Yeah, and I think that honestly, endurance that goes to any of the martial arts, whether it's striking or grappling, because you can throw hard on the feet for 30 seconds a minute, but if you're gassed, you're not going to get a whole lot of power out of anything. So, and your technique goes to shit as well. So, I can
you quit thinking. Hard to think when you're tired.
That as well, also. So, let's say everything works out, you win. What do you have to do to impress Dana White in this fight and possibly get offered? I mean, the contender series is over now, but get offered a contract or future considerations?
Man, like I said, I think I just need to go be me. I believe that I belong in the UFC. I believe that 100%, and I think that if I go have my best performance, then that will show and it'll be clear. And if it's not, then it's not. But I think that it will be. I'm 14-4, two in a row. I've got 10 finishes, so I'll be 15-4, 11 finishes, three fights in a row. Like, I don't know much more, like who else is in line ahead of me. But, that list has got to be getting thin.
Absolutely. And again, this is a fight I'm really looking forward to. The whole fight card, I saw your fight with JJ, definitely was interested in that. But the entire fight card in general, as we mentioned before, should be really, really good. So good on both Fury for putting together this card and the UFC, who, I mean, obviously had a hand in helping put it together when a guy from the Contender Series got a fight pretty much immediately on that card in Joe Holmes. So, all right, now we'll get to the last part here. We'll talk about the upcoming UFC main event. So on ESPN Plus, November 13th, this is actually the night before your fight. UFC Fight Night, Holloway versus Rodriguez. We have a featherweight main event between Max Holloway and Yair Rodriguez. So taking a look at that fight, just if you can, make a comment on it. And if you have a prediction, of course, we'd like to hear it as well.
Man, that's going to be a fun fight. That's going to be a fan fight for sure. Two really good strikers. They're a little different in their striking approach. I'm a huge Max Holloway fan. I'd like to see him get back on top and get to the belt. So I think that my prediction, a lot of times, I'm a fan when it comes to fighting. And so when I'm watching the UFC, there's the scientist Trey that wants to really analyze the matchup and what do I think is going to happen. But I always answer with what I want to happen. And I would like to see Max Holloway win and get back to title contention and win the belt back.
Yeah, and I he looked really good in his last fight against Calvin Kattar, where he basically said, I'm the best boxer in MMA. And it's hard to argue with that when you watch that performance, because Kattar is a beast on the feet, and he just dominated him. With Rodriguez, it's weird. When he finally hits the cage, he'll have been out of competition for 2 years. His last fight was in October of 2019, so he's really been on the shelf for a while. So I think that's an intangible as well. I will go with Max Holloway. I'll take it. It's a head pick and a heart pick because I want him to win, but I also think he has the chops to win in this one. So, that is on ESPN Plus.
Max also has a chin that holds up like a chin of iron. And so, it'll be interesting to see how Yair handles the volume. Is that a 5-round fight being the main event?
Yes, 5-round main event.
Man, I also think that favors Max Holloway always.
I agree. But, a guy like Yair trains in Mexico City a lot of the times at elevation, so he's going to have the cardio too, one would think.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, well, again, Trey, thank you so much. This is the part of the show where I'll give you some time. The floor is yours. If there's anybody you'd like to shout out, thank, whatever you want, where we can find you on social media, the floor is yours.
Yeah, man, obviously, Glory MMA, I'm a frontline soldier, always representing. And then Iridium Sports Management, my coach James Krause, and then my sponsor, Native Hemp Company. If you're in the Kansas City area looking for premium CBD products, check them out, Ogden MMA. We'll get you 20% off. And then social media, it's marathon_MMA at Instagram. That's the only one I really mess with.
Awesome. Thank you for that. And then I will do a quick advertisement, guys. You don't have to check. Just check old episodes for the social media and everywhere to find this. But we have, if you're in the greater Illinois area right now, my coach Richard Abraham is putting on his first Muay Thai show November 19th in Lombard, Illinois at the Brower House. Tickets still available, but not many left. So support local MMA, not even MMA, Muay Thai. Support local fight promoters, support local fighters as they either start or continue on their journey towards, you know, the pro ranks or to get into a bigger stage. So again, that is November 19th in Lombard, Illinois, Maximus Promotions. So again, Trey, thank you so much for giving us your time, and we really look forward to your fight. Again, your fight will be November 15th, 14th, excuse me.
On my birthday.
On your birthday, even better. Yep. November 14th, and if I'm not mistaken, that will be on UFC Fight Pass.
Correct.
Awesome. So we'll take a check out there. So again, thank you very much. So for Trey Ogden, my name is Riley Contek, saying continue watching the fights, continue watching this show, and go fuck yourselves. Good night.
I appreciate you, brother.
Thank you very much.